Welcome to the second episode of Screenshots. My name is Mark Fischel, and I'm here joined by my co-host, Juan Araya. Juan, what do we have in store for our viewers today?
Well, Mark Parsons is coming for a great interview with you, and then Mark is going to give everybody a tip on how to volley.
Okay, terrific. Hope everyone enjoys it. Hi, this is Mark Fischel, and I'm here with Mark Parsons, the two-time defending national champion. Mark, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Mark, last year at Nationals, you and Johan played what many thought was the match of the tournament against Scott Estes and Mike Cochran. Can you take us through that match? It was a tremendously exciting match, last match of the night on Saturday night, the quarterfinals.
That's a match that kind of sticks out last season as probably the match that kind of meant the most at the time, and a match that Johan and I definitely wanted to play. We were excited when the draw came out to see them, not because we really wanted to have to play them, but previous in the year they had beaten us in Chicago, and Johan and I definitely were looking forward to the chance to get some revenge. It turned out that we ended up playing them last match of the day with no one else on. It started to snow. A lot of things, I guess other elements came into play.
Now the match starts and you guys unveil a new formation and steamroll on the first set. So talk to me a little about the formation and how that evolved.
It was something that we actually started. We did it first at Soundshore against Alex Benchila and Juan Araya. And we used it a couple of times there. And then we kind of went back to our normal position there, but it was something that Johan and I continually talked about, and was something that we knew we would probably need to use again. And before Nationals, we spoke about it some more, and we were fairly confident on our game plan going into the match about how we wanted to utilize it. And it kind of, worked the way that we wanted it to until they switched sides, the snow happened, a couple other things kind of got in the way in the second set. But in the first set, it went the way we wanted it to in attacking the deuce court player.
Now, one of the interesting things about the match is it was one of those rare matches that Johan did not play his best. And I really felt like in the tiebreaker, you picked up the team when he was struggling. Did you mentally change your game and your approach when you saw Johan struggling?
I just didn't want to go to a third set. We made the changeover, and there was some negativity going on the court, I guess, from everyone. Partly because of when you start to lose points in a tight match like that, everyone kind of gets on themselves and sometimes their partners. I just remember on the changeover thinking, I do not want to play a third set. So we had a little chat, as I'm sure most people saw who watched it on the live stream. And, I think it kind of picked both of us up, and we were lucky enough to pull up the set.
Okay. We're early in the 2014-2015 season. You haven't played a tournament yet. Talk to me a little bit about your approach in the transition from tennis to paddle and what you try and focus on to maximize the effectiveness of your game.
I transition a little bit later than most. Some guys have played two tournaments, and with Rochester coming up this weekend, some guys will have already played three before I've played one. Chicago generally starts my season. I have played Atlantic in the past, but not this year. Keeping healthy and keeping my body in one piece is my biggest goal at the beginning of the season until I can start to, get into playing some practice matches. I like to get a few league matches under my belt before I start playing in the NRTs. Chicago is going to be stacked this year from what I know, and it's been fun to kind of watch the first couple of tournaments and see a few new teams that are coming about, and seeing that the level of competition this year is going to be very high.
So let's talk about that a little bit. Broderick and Palmer have obviously started the season with a splash, winning the first two tournaments without the loss of a set, and maybe have emerged as your main competition for your potential three-peat. Talk to me a little bit about them and the other teams that you see as your main competition.
Well, I mean, Drew's always been, in my opinion, probably the top player in the game right now, other than probably Johan. I put those two at the top. And, Drew partnered with anyone is going to be very strong. And when it's in regards to Jared Palmer, they're going to be extremely strong. I've played league with Palmer last year. and his game has taken leaps and bounds, and it's only going to get better as the season goes on, as he gets to play against more and more of the guys. They're definitely going to be a tremendous team. And then you've got Leonard Jonasson making his appearance again this year, which is awesome. Great to see him back playing again this year. Him and Juan will be a force to be reckoned with. They took us 6-6 the last time we played them in a match that, minus an ankle getting rolled, could have gone either way.
At Indian Trail in the semifinals of the 2013 Nationals.
Correct. And that was a roller coaster match, and we ended up getting a little lucky. But you know, those are the matches we look forward to playing. I spoke with Johan a couple days ago, and I'm a little bummed that Palmer and Broderick aren't playing charities. You know, one thing that's changed in the way I view matches now is that I look forward to playing the best teams. I used to look at draws and hope, oh, I hope so and so's not on my side, and so on and so forth. And Johan's helped me a lot with that mentally, in that I look forward to playing the big teams. It's something where, you know, we want to play them. We want to play them multiple times and try to feel everything out and go from there. And, you know, I think our first shot at them would be Sound Shore if the draw would permit it. And, you know, hopefully we'll get a look at them early.
Boy, that's a really interesting concept. And it really seems like that's a major transition in terms of being a top player, to go from, oh, I hope my draw has some of the weaker teams in it, to, hey, I want to play those guys.
Yeah, I mean, it was odd. I remember it was probably a year or so ago when it happened, and I remember talking about, I believe it was Juan and Leonard at the time, and Johan's, yeah, I really hope that we get a chance to play them. I kind of was thrown off by it a little bit, like, why would you want to play probably our biggest competition in the draw? And then I started to realize that, you know, he thrives on playing those big matches and playing against the best, and putting our best against their best, and let's see who has it that day. And it definitely changed my opinion. I really look forward now to playing the top teams, and hoping that they are on my side of the draw. If it happens that they're, you know, not on the, if our rankings permit it to be.
Now, you've had the benefit of playing with some really smart partners. Brian O'Connor accepted. So you started off with Steve Baird teaching you the game, and then the aforementioned Brian. We won't get into that. But then you had a great period with Mike Stulak and with Johan. Can you talk a little bit about what you learned from each of those terrific partners?
The odd part is I learned a lot from Brian.
Learned what not to do?
No. Look, Brian taught me how to have fun out here. We were a pretty good team. Most people don't realize that we finished, I believe, top five the year that we played in Cincinnati. We beat Cochran and Estes in that Nationals, and had a very good Nationals. But Brian definitely taught me how to have fun out there, which to this day I still do. For those who know me and know my attitude on court, it's, you know, the fun factor has to be there for me. Steve Baird, you can't say enough about Steve. Steve, I still remember the day that, you know, he introduced me to the game, and kind of taught me the game from the ground up. Literally, he's taught me, you know, as much as anyone else. Jim Kaufman was a huge influence on me. He gave me privates at one point. And then Stulak, as I call it, you know, Stulak is my PhD in paddle. I went from kind of, you know, being a decent paddle player, and then once I started to play with Mike, it's like learning from the epitome of paddle. The fight, the how to play the game, and dissect the team that you're playing against. There's no value level that I could ever put on what Mike taught me, because I think it's the highest that there is. And, you know, Johan has brought into my game the ability to want to play those big matches, which, you know, I think early on in my career I was probably not afraid of the big matches, but it was like, all right, now I've really got to focus here. Whereas Johan has learned, and or has taught me to learn how to, you know, enjoy those matches and want those matches to happen more often.
Now, you started playing the game in 2005, 2006, somewhere in that era?
Yeah, that's about right.
So you were really part of the group that changed the sport, from the kind of the old style of patient lobbing play that was kind of typified by the Goodspeed Manzingers, to the new style of game that yourself and David Caldwell and Juan and Johan play. Talk to me about that, and talk to me as you have seen the game evolve. Because I'm sure once you start playing, a lot of people said, hey, Mark, you shouldn't be hitting your overheads that way. That's not the way to do it. But obviously you had a belief in how to play the game, and the game has changed dramatically with that.
Yeah, look, I was lucky. Steve Baird didn't tell me anything for the first month. He wanted me to do what I thought was right in regards to what balls to hit and how to hit them. The game's changed in that I think we're being a little more aggressive from the baseline than people have been in the past. But at the same time, it's still a game of errors. It's still a game of percentages. I think the top players in today's game have become better at realizing how they can take risk, but at a higher percentage level, if that makes sense. Meaning, yes, we're hitting a bigger ball than probably they were 10 years ago, but we're also now hitting the ball to a higher percentage spot as opposed to going for, you know, balls between guys. We're now oftentimes going at guys. You know, the ball nowadays does not complement the striker, so to speak. Where I believe the Vitter ball, which I did not have, you know, the ability to play with growing up, or I guess growing up, learning the game, the Vitter ball used to, I guess, reward great shots. Whereas now the ball, the better shot that you hit that gets through someone just comes off a screen and the point continues. So I think we've just gotten a little better at, you know, hitting harder balls, but to a higher percentage spot.
Okay, final question, Mark. I know you're also a top teacher. What would you tell the club player? What would you tell the club player to focus on to improve his game the most?
I'm big on volleys. If you've ever done a camp with me or you've taken lessons with me, I'm huge on volleys. I'm huge on getting low and getting your stance a little wider than probably what you're used to having your stance. And I'm also big on just telling people to get the volley in the court. I think an emphasis has been on in the past about getting volleys deep and getting them past the service line. I'm a huge believer on just getting your volley in. And, you know, if you're looking to actually do anything with it, keep it lower than giving high balls. You know, I think the old teachings of, you know, lobbing in the green and driving in the blue have kind of gone out the window a little bit. With the way the ball bounces now, people in the green are able to drive the ball just as well as they can in the blue.
And it really, really seems like it's more a point of contact than location on the court.
I think height of ball has become the biggest thing in our sport now. I don't think necessarily where the ball is, but if the ball is low and it happens to be inside the service box, difficult for someone to drive that ball and have them be successful in getting it in. And vice versa, if the ball is deep and someone's in the green hitting, but it's nice and high, they have the ability to still hit down at you, which can cause you to have to hit a tough volley.
Well, Mark, thank you for joining us, and hope you have a terrific season, and maybe we'll catch up with you later in the season prior to Nationals.
Sounds good. Thanks, Mark.
Hello, I'm here at the Country Club of Darien. We just played a practice match with Carl Levanat and a bunch of guys, and I have here Carl, the director of Country Club of Darien. Carl, what do you think about the practice match today? How did it go?
Yeah, it was good. It was good to get eight guys out here. It's always fun practicing with the guys early in the season. It's a little tough, but we all had fun.
So how are you getting ready for the season? Are you going to play with Faisal Razali again this season?
Yeah, Faisal and I are going to play again. We're going to hopefully have some fun again this season.
Are you planning on playing a lot of tournaments?
We hope so. We're going to play probably the same schedule as last year.
Now, the important question is, do you think you're going to qualify for the President's Cup team this year?
I definitely won't qualify for the President's Cup team. You know, they might not win without me, but I don't think I'll qualify.
We all know that Carl was a very important part of the team last year from Region 2. He was the only player that lost two matches. I know. But he's one of the most well-liked guys in the area. And thank you, Carl, for letting us practice today at Country Club of Darien.
That will be the last time Juan practices at the Country Club of Darien.
And we're still here at the Country Club of Darien, this time with Mark Innes, who works at the club. He works with Carl Levanat. We like to say with. We're teammates. Mark, is this going to be your first full season as the APTA National Ranking Tournament player?
Yeah, this will be the first season I play most of the tournaments. Last season I played a few, but this season we'll play a few more.
Who's going to be your partner this season?
The Mick Erdoya from Aspetak.
No, he actually works at Innes Arden.
There we go. The Mick Erdoya.
So how does it feel that you don't know where your partner works?
Not too good, actually. Not very good at all. Shucks, that's not good. I'm going to have to spend a little more time together.
Well, we just practiced with Mark here, and he has amazing hands, great tennis player. So what do you think you have to improve to get your game going and be able to break through this season?
I think returns. I'm going to have to get my returns a little better, and also that drive, get a little more solid.
Well, I disagree with him. He was making every return and every drive against me. But he played great. We had a great practice match. And that's it for today. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Hello, we're here with Mark Parsons. And great interview with Mark Fischel, by the way.
Thank you.
Great
He's stuff. A good interviewer.
Great stuff. So we're going to discuss a little bit about the volley. He's going to give everybody a few tips about what he was talking about during the interview. So Mark, you want to go ahead and hit some?
Yeah, definitely. One thing that I just like to talk about is a lot of people stand with their legs kind of almost in like same length as their shoulder or same width as their shoulders. I like to get a little bit wider and get a knee bend. What that does is it doesn't allow you to flinch as much. So once I'm down here, and I'll show it with one hand to begin, and then watch, how I'm trying to do is just get the ball in play, not trying to do anything specific. Look at my feet. There's a lack of movement going on. It's not a very athletic thing that I'm doing, and all you're trying to do is put the ball in the court. I do like to volley with two hands, and if you do like to do that, you just add the second hand, and all of a sudden, I've got a little bit more stability, and I can go ahead and pretty much block the ball all day long. If Juan and I were to stay here long enough, I'd feel fairly confident that he would miss before I did, and I'm sure long-term, Mark and Juan will both talk to you about lobbing and how that's going to basically start to be the advantageous point for people on the baseline.
Well, that's a great tip. Thank you, Mark. I hope that will help my volleys.
Absolutely.